story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Monday, 6:43 a.m., and New York City was gaga over its latest architectural unveiling, a 27-story building made of mahogany whose top looked like a Persian rotunda, draped from which were four yellow solar panels. A handful of detractors said it looked like knobs on a four-poster bed with slices of Swiss cheese hanging on it. I was working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly. The captain is Joe Greco. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. Well, if it isn't the Ancient Mariner. Morning, George.
Hey, Pard. What's new?
You're asking me?
Oh, Martha picked this up for me at Abercrombie's. You like it?
It's fetching. But why are you wearing it?
Didn't you hear the weather report? There's a 50% chance of rain.
In our office?
No. Outside, Kate. I didn't want to take a chance with our new Big Apple outfits. Thanks, Harvey.
They are nice, aren't they?
Didn't you at least bring an umbrella?
No, George, I'm an optimist. If there's a 50% chance that it will rain, there's also a 50% chance that it won't rain, so I'll just stand in that 50% of the day.
You're a pretty funny mathematician, Kate.
You know, I never did understand why those weather predictors do that percentage thing anyway.
But to cover themselves, I guess. Nobody can predict the weather precisely all the time, so under a certain set of conditions, for example, they might say that there's a 90% chance it'll rain.
Uh-huh. 9 out of 10 times, right?
Right. Well, you know what they say. Everyone talks about the weather, but nobody does anything about it.
They do say that. But you're going to do something about it.
Morning, Skipper. Do something about what?
The weather.
I already did. I got a new slicker.
What's up, Captain Greco?
I wish I knew for certain. Have you heard of SWI?
No.
I don't know much about it, but it stands for Strategic Weather Initiative. Some wacky inventor, Spiro Gearloose, has developed some kind of machine that can control the weather, or so he claims.
You mean some device that seeds clouds to cause rain?
I think it's more complicated than that. Anyway, he's going to unveil it at a ceremony at MacArthur Airport, and we've got to supply security.
Security? Against what? Weather swipers?
The government has bought into this project. People from Washington will be there. Congressmen, folks from the Polygon, all kinds of bigwigs.
So what's our mission?
Get out there and put together a plan to make the area secure. The ceremony will take place in Hangar 1313. Good luck.
The two 13s will need good luck. Come on, Pard.
Let's roll. Slicker, George.
Oh, right.
And if it doesn't rain, you can always help me across the street.
Yeah.
George and I used maps of the area to determine the best places to set our people. We wanted to secure as much area as possible with as few people, getting maximum efficiency. I'm Kate Monday. This is my partner, George.
Frankly,
Mathnet.
I'm Congressman Stuart, Folly. This is Lieutenant Colonel Stanley,
Powell.
And this is Spiro Gearloose. He's the father of SWI.
Charmed, I'm sure.
Well, we've only got about 2 hours before the unveiling of SWI. Get cracking.
Well, I don't mean to appear dense.
That's all right.
But just what is SWI?
It's the most revolutionary invention I don't know.
Those little plastic things you use to pack dishes in that get all over the rug.
We know that it means Strategic Weather Initiative, but we don't know what that means.
I don't think we should tell them until we run a security check on them.
Colonel, they're going to hear all about it in 2 hours anyway.
Well, just the same.
Imagine what it would be like if we could put a big electronic dome all around the Earth.
A big dome?
All around the Earth?
Doesn't that sound super duper?
I guess I don't follow you.
That's what SWI will do.
Well, I guess with a dome around the Earth, we'd never lose anything. I mean, it'd have to be around someplace.
Mr. Gearloose, working with a secret committee in Congress, which I head.
And with me, head of Polygon's crack, watch out behind you, division.
Have developed a way to control weather throughout the world. Don't you see what a boon to mankind this is?
I guess so. You may never need your slicker again, Pard.
I control the weather by moving the weather. Isn't that a spiffy notion?
You move the weather?
Let's say there are raging floods in Bangladesh, and at the same time, drought in the United States. I can move the moisture from the floods into the drought areas, thus saving lives and crops and businesses.
That's amazing. But does it work?
Of course it works. Polygon wouldn't spend a bunch of money on some jerky idea that doesn't work, would it?
Gosh, no. But just how is this accomplished?
It's all handled by an unmanned aircraft, the Z-13, which can be flown into orbit.
Like a space capsule?
Yes, and it's specially equipped, and it's more maneuverable and can be controlled by radio beams by me right here on Earth. I can deploy the panels to block out the sun. I can stir up the clouds with chaff. I can make the wind blow.
You too can understand why we need the utmost in security. If SWI should fall into enemy hands.
I see. They could control the weather and make things pretty rotten for us.
Worse, they could conquer us without firing a shot.
Yes, of course. The plane is in the hangar?
That's right.
May we see it?
You can have a peek.
A peek?
Yes, walk that way. That hole in the door. The temperature is controlled and critical, so we don't want the door open until the ceremony.
Wow. Take a look at this, Kate.
Pretty impressive. Just one thing.
What?
There's a giant hare.
What? A giant hare?
On the plane.
Something's wrong!
What's this, a slide projector?
Where's the plane?
It's been plane mapped.
Someone will hang for this and turn slowly, slowly in the wind. I gotta use the phone.
George, I'm gonna take a look around.
Didn't you have this place under guard?
24 hours a day. Nobody could have gotten in or out without proper identification.
Well, somebody did, and they did it in a truck.
The plane could have been stolen at any time. The guards have been looking through that peephole and seeing just a picture of the plane.
The tracks are pretty fresh, Congressman.
You sure?
It rained here last night, didn't it?
Yes, it poured. Stopped about 3 a.m.
Then the plane had to have been stolen after 3 a.m.
Where do you get off with that kind of thinking, Sibby?
If they'd stolen the plane before 3 a.m., the tracks that are outside would have washed away.
Oh.
Can we find the man that was on guard duty at the time?
He's on his way. Report!
Private Willie Klodge reporting, sir.
Stand at ease. I said stand at ease, not collapse.
Were you on duty last night, Private?
Yes, sir.
Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, sir.
I was.
Did anything unusual happen on your tour?
You mean like, did a big truck come here and drive inside the hangar?
Yes.
Yes.
More questioning revealed that the driver showed Willie proper ID, drove the truck into the hangar, remained for about 10 minutes, and left about 6 a.m. Willie said he looked through the peephole and the plane looked fine. He didn't know he was looking at a picture. We decided to check out those tire tracks. Look at this, George. Two sets of tracks, one is deeper than the other.
Uh-huh.
These tracks were made when the truck came in. They're not as deep as these. The second tracks were made when the truck left. They're deeper.
That's because the truck was carrying a heavy airplane in its cargo bay. I'm sorry, Mr. Gearloose, but I'm afraid you're going to have to pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and...
start all over again. The Z-13 took nearly 20 years to perfect.
But now that your plans...
I have no plans.
Your records.
The mission was so important.
Yes.
So hush-hush.
You were afraid the plans and records...
would fall into enemy hands?
And now, the plane has fallen into enemy hands.
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Monday, 9:43 a.m., and the dreaded had happened. Trash collectors throughout the Big Apple went on strike and refused to pick up New Yorkers' trash, lending a new air to the city. I was working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Franklin. The captain is Joe Greco. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. We had just gotten involved in the age-old saying, everybody talks about the weather, but nobody does anything about it. Apparently, someone had. We decided to look at earlier, well-acted scenes to refresh ourselves.
Have you heard of SWI?
No.
I don't know much about it, but it stands for Strategic Weather Initiative. Some wacky inventor, Spiro Gearloose, has developed some kind of machine that can control the weather, or so he claims.
Now, all kinds of kooky people invent all kinds of kooky things all the time, but this time our government was involved with its development, so we know it was serious. We met Congressman Stuart, Folly, Lieutenant Colonel Stanley South, and father of SWI, Spiro Gearloose.
I control the weather by moving the weather. Isn't that a spiffy notion?
You move the weather?
Let's say there are raging floods in Bangladesh, and at the same time, drought in the United States. I can move the moisture from the floods into the drought areas, thus saving lives and crops and businesses.
It sounded like a unique concept, and George and I were asked to secure the area where the special SWI plane was to be unveiled for the first time. We were in the process of doing so when...
What's this, a slide projector?
Where's the plane?
It's been plane-napped.
Someone will hang for this and turn slowly, slowly in the wind.
The special plane Z-13 had indeed been stolen right out from under the military noses, and there was no backup.
The Z-13 took nearly 20 years to perfect.
But now that your plans...
I have no plans.
Your records.
The mission was so important.
Yes.
So hush-hush.
You were afraid the plans and records...
would fall into enemy hands?
And now, the plane... has fallen into enemy hands.
George, from the description of the truck we got from the soldier, I've got its specs.
It was a big one?
Yeah, an 18-wheeler. There are several manufacturers, but their specs are all similar.
Those big rigs are fast, too. I don't mean from 0 to 60, but once they get rolling.
According to the specifications, they can cruise comfortably at 80 miles per hour.
I'm sure they can, but state troopers give them tickets for doing that. I'm trying to figure out how far away our truck could have gotten.
It's been 4 hours since the soldier said the truck left.
And if we estimate that he was averaging at best 50 miles per hour,
50 times 4, 200.
200 miles. Now, how would that represent itself on this map?
What's the scale of the map?
1 inch stands for 6 miles.
Let's see, 200 divided by 6 is more than 30.
Holy cow, puts it right off the map.
So our truck could be off the map, too.
Got a map with the gap, George?
We're trying to see how far our truck could have gotten if he made 50 miles an hour.
But there's no way he could average 50 miles an hour on a Monday morning.
What do you mean?
Monday morning traffic.
It's the nose.
Are you sure, Benny?
Sure, I'm sure. I know New York traffic like the back of my hand. Call DOT.
Good idea. Hello, this is Kate Monday, Mathnet. Can you tell me what traffic was like this morning moving away from MacArthur Airport? Uh-huh. From 6 a.m. until now. That bad. I see. In all directions? Thank you, sir. You were right, Benny. The Long Island Expressway was bumper to bumper.
Hardly failed. They'd have hit the same thing the closer they got to the city. If he had gone north, he'd have run into traffic on the Whitestone Bridge. The Triborough is always clobbered this time of the day. So is the GW. And they don't allow trucks on the southern state.
What are you saying, Benny?
I'm saying he'd have been lucky to average, 15, 20 miles per hour today.
Okay, worst case. 20 times 4 is 80 miles. That's a lot smaller radius. A little more than 13 inches on this map.
Cover.
I'll call a dispatcher and have him put out an APB and call all police units in this area.
Of course, we don't know that he's heading out of town with the Z-13 for sure.
Where else would he go? It's hard enough to find a parking place for a car in New York, let alone a big truck with an airplane in it.
So the Z-13 has fallen into evil clutches.
I like the way you turn a phrase.
So they've got this miraculous SWI. What do they do with it?
Okay, all police agencies in this area have been notified to stop all unmarked 18-wheel trucks and search them.
I think I'd test it to see if it works. It sounds like another cockamamie idea to me.
It works. The people in Washington, D.C. told us it did.
I rest my case.
Hello, Mr. Gearloose. This is Kate Monday. I was wondering if you could answer a question about the Z-13. The Z-13. Remember the weather plane you built? That's right. How much runway does it need to take off? I see. By the way, how are you feeling? Oh, that's nice. Goodbye.
How's he feeling?
Better. His mother just baked cookies.
How about the runway?
It only needs 5,000 feet.
That's almost a mile.
Yeah, but it's a pretty common length. There must be at least a dozen airports in this area with that length strip.
It's a long shot, but we've got to take it. We'll notify all airport supervisors and tell them to be on the watch out for any unusual aircraft that ask to use their facilities.
Maybe it's time to play What If.
Is that like that one we played last week?
Uh-uh. That was What Do We Know.
And the winner of What Do We Know moves on to the second round of What If.
What if I decide to launch the plane?
But what if I can't get an airport to let me use a runway?
What if we think of another place to launch the plane from? Like?
I see, yeah. What if it takes off from a deserted stretch of highway?
Is there any deserted highway in this area?
Sure, there's always some road construction going on someplace. They have to close down the road so no one will run them over while they're leaning on their idiot sticks.
We can find that out, too. I'll call NYPD operations and get them on it.
When you're trying to solve a problem, at times you have to use a number of hypotheses. That's why playing games like What If helps us.
They'll let us know.
See you later.
Any news, Mathnetters? Anything at all?
We're working on it, Congressman Folly.
It's a harsh, cruel world out there, civvies. I just want that plane back before they use it on us.
They?
Yes, they. As in them, those, the ones who would enslave.
Oh,
Mathnet Monday. Oh, how many? 17 airports? You did, good. Only one. Thank you.
Is that research?
Yes. There are 17 airports that could accommodate the takeoff of the Z-13.
How about roadways?
Only one. They're rebuilding Interstate 684 again. There is a long enough stretch for it to take off from there.
What makes you think they'll try to launch the plane?
Sir, they are trapped, so to speak, in that area.
In that itty-bitty circle?
This represents an 80-mile radius, Colonel South.
Good work. If they're trapped, let's move in.
Well, perhaps the word trap was ill-chosen.
They are inside here with the plane, and they can't get out without our knowing about it.
Well, that's not what I call trapped. What I call trapped. So your feeling is that they'll put this plane into orbit and...
And make their play. If we don't do what they want, they could weather us into submission.
They could scorch the earth and ruin next year's rutabaga crop, for example.
Oh, I don't like rutabagas. Disagree with you.
They could foul up traffic all over the country with snow and ice.
They could rain out baseball games.
And military parades. War as heck.
It would be economic chaos if someone with evil intent could control the weather, gentlemen.
Let me ask you this, Colonel South. If that plane were to be launched, could our radar detect it? Could we hit it with a missile?
Well, it should show up on a screen. Then we could zap it. Why don't we ask all the airports to shut down, not allow any planes in or out? If we saw a plane on the radar screen, then we would know it was our bogey, and we could bring it down.
Great idea, Congressman. I like the way you think.
Gentlemen, you can't expect international airports to stop all air traffic. It would cause major consternation.
I served with major consternation during the... You're right, of course. And we don't know if they're even going to fly the plane in the first place.
I'm afraid all we can do is cover the outlets and hope that someone spots our truck.
I hate to wait. Drives me bats.
There's a firing range in the basement, Colonel South. You need to freshen up.
I've got a message for you, Kate.
It's from Spiro Gearloose.
What does it say?
Kaboom.
Kaboom?
Kaboom. Hello, is Mr. Gearloose there? Yes, I'll hold. His mother's calling him. Mr. Gearloose, it's Kate Monday. Yes, I got your message, but I'm afraid I don't understand it.
Kaboom, it's self-explanatory. It just means kaboom.
Yes, sir.
There was something I forgot to tell you.
Uh-huh.
The Z-13 has to remain hooked up to a supercooling mechanism.
You mentioned that.
Did I mention why?
No.
It's because it employs superconductivity in its electronic system, and that system must remain cooled to minus 160 degrees Celsius.
That's very cold.
That's what those hoses and compressors were controlling at the hangar. The loss of the coolant will cause the system to explode.
Sir, was the Z-13 fueled with rocket propellant?
To the gills!
So an explosion on board the plane...
will ignite the fuel...
and the result is...
kaboom!
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Monday, 3:43 p.m., and pre-Christmas sales had bargain-hunting New York shoppers drooling. Even though Christmas was months away, it was not a pretty sight along Fifth Avenue. I was working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly. The captain is Joe Greco. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. It isn't every day that someone can do something about the weather, but we were just about to be able to. But, well, we decided to look at a few scenes from earlier episodes so we could keep our facts in order. Our government, along with an inventor named Spiro Gearloose, felt they had come up with a phenomenal idea.
Imagine what it would be like if we could put a big electronic dome all around the Earth.
A big dome?
All around the Earth?
Doesn't that sound super duper?
We were told that through this dome, we
have developed a way to control weather throughout the world. Don't you see what a boon to mankind this is?
Of course we could. If man could control weather, we would never again have to deal with floods and famines and blizzards and dust bowls. Never again have to listen to a TV weather person give us misinformation. But then, just as this newest miracle was about to be unveiled in the form of the Z-13...
Where's the plane?
It's been plane-napped.
Through Mathnet precise investigation, we learned that someone had forged documents, invaded the private sanctums of our airbase, and stolen the SWI plane, the Z-13. Using mathematics, estimation, and plenty of common sense, we were sure the plane was aboard a truck and somewhere within this vicinity. We put out an APB to all law enforcement agencies within the area to stop all unmarked 18-wheel vehicles and search them. But then we played what if, and George said,
what if I decide to launch the plane?
But what if I can't get an airport to let me use a runway?
What if we think of another place to launch the plane from? Like,
I see, yeah. What if it takes off from a deserted stretch of highway?
Is there any deserted highway in this area?
Sure, there's always some road construction going on someplace.
We put out further checks looking for its location, but then that seemed less important when we got a chilling phone call.
That's what those hoses and compressors were controlling at the hangar. The loss of the coolant will cause the system to explode.
Sir, was the Z-13 fueled with rocket propellant?
To the gills!
So an explosion on board the plane
will ignite the fuel.
And the result is?
Kaboom!
This was a tough one. Perhaps the toughest case we'd ever had to solve. We were trying everything we knew to locate that truck with a Z-13 on it, but no luck. We had to keep going and going fast because, well, kaboom. Any luck with the airports?
Nothing so far.
I checked all highway patrols. They've spotted and stopped 71 vehicles.
What did they find?
71 angry drivers. No one was carrying anything that resembled a plane in the cargo bay.
Yes, Clarence. Oh, send him in. Spiro Gearloose is here, Kate.
I asked him to come down. Figured he might be able to remember something about the plane that might help.
Good day to each of you.
Hi, Mr. Gearloose.
Call me Spiro. Oh, my mother sent some cookies.
Well, that's nice. Spiro. We've determined that the Z-13 is somewhere within this circle.
It's quite a bit of land, isn't it?
Yes, and it's densely populated. If the Z-13 were to blow up,
it would be a mess.
Do you have any idea how long this warm-up effect will take?
You mean how long it will take before...
Yes.
Yes, 36 hours.
That's only a day and a half.
It's already been nearly 10 hours. So that leaves us a little more than a day.
We've got to locate that truck, but how?
What if I turn on its radio?
What if you what?
Turn on the plane's radio. I have a remote control mechanism.
You mean you can activate the radio? Can you do anything else remotely?
Not until it's airborne. Then I can fly it with my joystick. Oh, it should be great fun.
You say you can activate its radio. That would mean it could transmit a signal?
That's right.
And we can track the signal and it will lead us directly to the plane?
I do believe that's what could happen.
Do you have the controls with you, Spiro?
Get cracking, Mr. G. Get cracking. Put it on the table.
Mathnet, frankly. Look, buddy. We're in the middle of solving a very important case, so knock it off with the crank calls, okay?
What's that?
Some nut. How long will it take you to activate a directional signal, Spiro?
Not too long. I just need to check out some of the connections.
Mathnet, frankly. Look, smart guy. I don't... Oh. Oh. Yes, sir. What is it, sir? I see, sir. Yes, sir. No problem, sir. We'll keep you posted, sir.
George? George? Who was that?
It was the crank caller again, only it wasn't a crank call. It was the president.
The president of what?
The president of us.
Why was he calling you? You didn't even vote for him.
Our government has been contacted by an organization called the Conspiracy of Anarchists, Robbers, Tough Guys, Evildoers, and Loonies.
Who?
Cartel.
You've heard of them?
An international group which sells weapons for those who make war.
They've got the Z-13, and they're going to sell it.
To whom?
Whom? To the highest bidder. They've already approached the superpowers, and they're in the process of reaching the rest of the first world countries, the second world countries, and the third world countries.
You've got to contact Cartel immediately and tell them they've got a gigantic lethal weapon that's about to blow up.
I bet they don't believe you.
We've got to make them believe us. We've only got 26 hours.
The president gave me their phone contact. It's an 800 number. No toll.
What's this? There's another number.
The other one is the president's answering service.
Hello? This is Kate Mundy. Is this Cartel? I have some disturbing news to tell you. The plane you are holding ransom is going to blow up in a matter of hours. I'm deadly serious, and if you don't listen, they're laughing.
They've got to believe.
Listen here, Cartel. If you don't return that plane...
What?
They put me on hold. They're playing recorded dental music.
I'm getting a signal from the plane.
What are you learning, Spiro?
This is the direction finder. It points the radio signals from the plane. It reads 13 degrees east of north, so we can plot that information on your map.
We need a north-south line through our Mathnet headquarters on the map. So, I'll draw a line parallel to this north-south line. We need to come east 13 degrees, right there. Now we complete the 13 degree angle.
And we know the plane is somewhere along here. We can't check out every possible storage place along the line.
We'll triangulate.
You'll need more information.
Yes. We'll need at least one more reading of the directional finder from a different location. We could get a good reading from here. Let's roll.
Roll?
That means let's go.
We decided to drive out of the city to get a second radio fix.
Yes. Won't be long now. Ooh, it's a fader signal.
Is that because of the distance we are from the plane?
Possibly. Could be atmospheric. Could be interference from the terrain. But we've got it!
What's the reading, Spiro?
52 degrees to the east of north.
I'll draw an angle of 52 degrees. And where this line...
intersects our first bearing line.
Is where the Z-13 is being held captive.
Looks like it's near a dumpy little town called Nouveau Riche.
Can you get us there, Benny?
I don't know. I've never been that far out of New York City before.
Think of it as an adventure.
We ought to be able to get there in an hour or so. Hold on.
What will you do when you get to the plane? Cartel will probably have it heavily guarded.
We'll make that judgment when we get there and assess the situation. We can always call for heavy backup. Through the diligent use of triangulation, we were about to close in on the Z-13, capture the members of Cartel, and save the free world from chaos and destruction. It had been a full day's work. We were in the area where our directional lines intersected. Now we had to find the plane.
What's this?
Looks looks like they're doing road work.
Or they were. No one is around now.
Maybe they ran out of dough. What shall I do?
Let's go on.
Look!
Just about
anywhere.
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Tuesday, 9:43 a.m., and New York was in a joyous mood as it hailed the end of the trash collector strike with a ticker tape parade on Lower Broadway. It was festive and gave vivid testimony to the thinking that permeates this great city. I was working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankley. The captain is Joe Greco. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. When you're trying to solve a tough problem, and we were, it's a good idea to go back over your facts, so we did, by using scenes from earlier episodes.
Have you heard of SWI?
No.
I don't know much about it, but it stands for Strategic Weather Initiative. Some wacky inventor, Spiro Gearloose, has developed some kind of machine that can control the weather, or so he claims.
So what's our mission? Whether the plane could control the weather, or whether it could not control the weather, was suddenly immaterial because...
it's been plane mapped.
And there was no backup system, and not likely to be one because...
I have no plan.
Your records.
The mission was so important.
Yes.
So hush-hush.
You were afraid the plans and records...
would fall into enemy hands?
And now, the plane has fallen into enemy hands.
Through intense investigations, problem-solving techniques, and a lot of hard work, we determined that the plane had been stolen and loaded aboard a large 18-wheel truck. We notified authorities in the area to stop all unmarked trucks and search them for the plane. Then we thought the thieves might try to fly the plane away, so we notified airports in the vicinity to contact us if anyone attempted to rent their facilities. We heard nothing from them. And then...
what if we think of another place to launch the plane from? Like...
I see, yeah. What if it takes off from a deserted stretch of highway?
We checked with the traffic department to locate deserted highways that could accommodate the plane, but then we learned we were in danger. The plane was no longer hooked up to its cooling system, and if it got overheated, the plane would blow up, causing real problems. If the Z-13 were to blow up,
it would be a mess.
Do you have any idea how long this warm-up effect will take?
You mean, how long it will take before...
yes.
Yes, 36 hours.
Now we were working against time. It's always best to give yourself plenty of time when trying to solve a problem, but occasionally you have no choice. Then we got a break. Through using a radio signal Spiro picked up from a transmitter he had implanted on the plane and using triangulation, we thought we might have located the Z-13.
Looks like it's near a dumpy little town called Nouveau Riche.
Can you get us there, Benny?
I don't know. I've never been that far outside New York City before.
Think of it as an adventure.
Benny drove us to Nouveau Riche. With time ticking like a bomb, we spotted an 18-wheel truck.
Hey,
was here. Look.
They disconnected the radio and left in the truck. But where's the plane?
Could be just about
anywhere. You ready, Stanley? Not even close. Try it again. You're not leading it enough.
Ready? Set? Pull!
Boy, the minute the teacher leaves the room.
Fine mess you've gotten us into, Stanley. Morning, Kate. Colonel South and I were just...
goofing off.
No. We were simulating the task of shooting down an airplane with a missile.
Uh-huh.
But something Colonel South might have to do once we locate the C-13.
Any word from Washington on it?
Not so far. They haven't found it. It's not in orbit, and they haven't identified it in suborbit.
Well, at least the threat of a devastating explosion has been lifted from our backs. Gearloose said once the plane was launched, the coolant temperature would automatically be reinstated.
Yes, I was not looking forward to the big kaboom.
I wonder what it would have sounded like.
Anything else from Cartel?
Every embassy in Washington, D.C. has been contacted and asked to submit sealed bids for the purchase of SWI.
Sealed bids?
It's the Democratic way, Mundy. That may be for me. I left this number with my office, codename Bird Brain.
Mathnet, Monday. Oh, hello, Mr. Gearloose. How are they meshing? What's that? Very well, if you think it's best, we'll be right there. Spiro thinks we should drop by his place.
Did he say why?
Just that it was important.
Let's roll.
Would it be all right, do you think, if I...
Of course, Colonel South. Glad to have you. If you get a call from Bird Brain, just take a message. Kate Monday, this is my partner, George.
Frankly, Mathnet.
That's nice. And you are?
Bird Brain, Lieutenant Colonel.
Come in, Spiro said to expect you.
Hello. Come in. I'm sorry my place is such a mess.
Looks spiffy to me, Spiro.
Son, will your little friend be wanting sandwiches?
No, Mom, that's not necessary.
What if I cut the crusts off?
No, thanks, Mom.
Should I bake cupcakes?
No, thanks, Mom.
You said you wanted to see us. Is it something about the plane?
Did you locate it?
No, that's just it. I haven't located it. Don't sweat it, Gearloose. The U.S. government can't plan it either. That doesn't surprise me. But the fact that I can't does.
I don't understand.
My Z-13 was built of a non-radar reflecting material.
I never heard of such a thing.
I shouldn't have said built of the material. The material coated the plane.
Coated it? Like a paint?
The skin of the plane was made of tightly woven membranes taken from bat's ears.
Bat's ears? You mean like in bat bats?
They have the facility of absorbing all signals that touch them. Radio waves are simply sucked up. They do not rebound.
So no one can ever detect the plane?
Not by radar. But if you stand downwind of it, it doesn't smell very good.
But you said you couldn't locate it. You have a means of tracing the Z-13?
Yes.
through a special computer chip made chiefly from guano. Look here. This is a suborbital radar scope. It shows me all aircraft flying in the area I choose to monitor.
You can see what's flying anywhere in the world?
A sector at a time, yes. Here. This scope shows me a complete picture of orbital flight. I can see space capsules, satellites, debris, everything, including, of course, cable movies.
And there's still no accounting for the Z-13?
That's true.
Maybe that means your equipment is non-functional.
No, that means the Z-13 was never launched.
You mean it's still on Earth?
Precisely.
But where?
I haven't the foggiest notion.
But doesn't that mean we're still in danger of a gigantic explosion?
Guaranteed.
And we've wasted all kinds of time. How much do we have left?
Right now, it's 1,300 hours.
What time is that?
1 p.m.? The plane's been missing for 31 hours!
That means we've got about 5 hours to find her before she explodes.
Sorry to be the bearer of bad news.
Better to know news than not know news, even if the news we know is not nice. We've got to find that plane. Hundreds of thousands of lives hang in the balance.
But the gosh darn thing could be anywhere. Well, they could have put it on another truck and driven it hundreds of miles from here.
No. The other truck would have been stopped at our checkpoints. It is still within the original area.
We didn't examine that truck very carefully.
Well, we didn't think it was necessary at the time. The plane seemed to have been launched.
Let's roll. Once again, we had overlooked information that might help us. We found the truck was a rental from Yahoo Rents Trucks. Inside the cab, we found a parking receipt and a contract. The manager of the parking lot said the truck had been parked there from 8:30 a.m. until 1:25 p.m. on Monday. That was after the plane was stolen. The manager of Yahoo Rents Trucks had other information. She said her records showed the truck was picked up at her offices at 11:30 p.m. Sunday night. She said it was a special order because the truck was so large it had to be brought from their New Jersey lot. Neither could give a clear description of the driver. We had a check of the mileage on the truck's odometer and decided to see if we could deduce anything from that.
Kate, this is the mileage that was on the truck when Cartel picked it up. 33,713.
Uh-huh.
And this is the mileage when we found it abandoned. 33,863. The difference is 150. So the truck was driven
150 miles. Let's figure where he went. We know he started in Manhattan.
And he went to MacArthur Field. According to the NYPD mileage chart, that's 47 miles.
And we can assume he drove back to Manhattan after they put the nab on the plane because he was at the parking lot at 8:30 a.m.
In Monday morning's traffic, that figures. Benny said he could make about 20 miles per hour. That's about 50 miles in 2.5 hours, so it could be 47 miles.
Then he drove north to New Boriche. That's where we found it abandoned.
According to the chart, the mileage from Manhattan to New Boriche is 53 miles. That adds up to 147 miles. That means he drove around for an additional 3 miles.
He certainly was efficient, but I don't know what that means.
Kate, what it might mean is he left the plane somewhere in New York City. He only drove an additional 3 miles.
So he didn't drive to New Jersey and dump the plane?
Right. He didn't spend enough miles. We've narrowed our search area tremendously.
But he could have driven anywhere along the route and dumped the plane. Remember the 3 extra miles. He could have driven 1.5 miles off the road and 1.5 miles back.
Without being spotted? That's affluent suburbia, Kate. People get mad if you leave old cars and airplanes in your front lawn.
New York City isn't the easiest place to hide a plane either, George. A New Yorker would spot it right away. Of course, they might not say anything about it.
Kate, warehouses. Near the parking lot, there are warehouses. He might have spent those 3 miles looking for a warehouse.
So you think Cartel swiped the plane, put it on the truck, drove back into town and put the plane in a warehouse?
Yep, and he drove it out of town and abandoned it to throw us off the trail.
If that's the case, George, if we don't find that bomb...
Rents are going to be lower in New York.
So is New York. Can we get the addresses of the warehouses in the area where our plane would fit?
I'll get the NYPD real estate squad on it.
Mathnet, Monday. Oh, hello, Congressman Folly. The sealed bids were open. Who bought SWI? Who? Are you saying doodle-dee-doo? I never heard of them. An emerging fourth world nation, I see. Thanks for the information. How much? Wow. Thank you, sir.
The real estate people are checking for us. They'll have the info in a couple of minutes.
That was Washington. A country named Doodle-Dee-Doo just bought SWI for $10 billion.
I hope they can stop payment on the check because it's 3 p.m. and in 3 hours and 7 minutes, there won't be any SWI.
Unless we can find it and launch it. I'm going to call Spiro and ask him to meet us.
Benny, what have you got?
Real estate people sent this up. This is a list of all the warehouses in this area. These are the floor plans and addresses.
Spiro is coming in. Are those the plans for the warehouses?
Uh-huh. Let's call the managers and ask if they've rented out any space in the past couple of days.
What if you're in on it?
Good point. They would lie. We'll have to investigate personally.
How much time we got before she blows?
2 hours and 52 minutes.
I'm glad the Giants are out of town this week.
Benny drove us to the west side where the warehouses were located. The plan was I would engage the manager in conversation while George and Benny looked for the plane. Warehouse. Have you got any space available, Mr. Sludge?
Yeah, it depends on what you just want to put in it.
How about an airplane?
An airplane? You just want to store an airplane here?
Maybe.
The hubcaps will be ripped off the first night.
Nothing, Kate. There's no sign of the Z-13.
The what?
Never mind, Mr. Sludge. You are our last best hope.
Yo, Sludge, you know any place around here where somebody could hide an airplane?
You got one, too? I remember when you yuppies rode motor scooters. What is this world coming through?
2 hours and 13 minutes, Mr. Sludge. We may find out.
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Tuesday, 4:47 p.m., and the city's workforce was flattened. New Yorkers who rode the subway to work were being knocked down when they got to street level by people who jogged to work, and then run over by people who roller skated or bicycled to work. I was working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly. The captain is Joe Greco. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. We were working on a case of monumental importance, and to refill our nearly empty think tanks, we decided to look at earlier scenes from the story. First, George and I were told that people in our government
have developed a way to control weather throughout the world.
And then we learned that the airplane, a one-of-a-kind model called the Z-13,
it's been plane napped.
And then we learned that a no longer functioning cooling system
will ignite the fuel.
The result is
kaboom!
And when we asked how long before this explosion would take place, putting our citizenry in jeopardy, we were told
36 hours.
We couldn't find the plane or the people who were responsible for the theft, although we did learn their identity. Arms dealers known as Cartel, the conspiracy of anarchists, robbers, tough guys, evildoers, and loonies, and they were going to sell it to the highest bidding country.
That country turned out to be an emerging fourth world nation named Doodly Doo. They bought it for $10 billion.
I hope they can stop payment on the check, because it's 3 p.m. and in 3 hours and 7 minutes, there won't be any SWI.
The sand was slipping through the hourglass, and we hit one dead end after another.
Nothing, Kate. There's no sign of the Z-13.
The what?
Never mind, Mr. Sludge. You were our last best hope.
Not much time left, Kate.
Not many ideas left either.
Perhaps you should try to evacuate the city. There are 7 million people here. You might save some lives.
More lives might be taken by the panic.
Besides, we don't know where the explosion will occur. We could drive people right into the center of it.
I wonder when Doodly Doo was supposed to take possession of the Z-13.
So do I, Mr. G.
And so do I. Washington, D.C. information. Can you give me the number of the embassy of Doodly Doo? You have two numbers, but one is not in service. Can you give me a good Doodly Doo? Thanks.
Calling Doodly Doo?
Yes, George. They must be in contact with cartel. Maybe we can... Hello, may I speak with the ambassador, please? Oh, could you tell me where he's staying? Thank you.
What?
The ambassador and his entourage are in New York City.
Where are they staying?
The Umpire Hotel. Know where it is?
Yeah, it's in the 60s. It's run by Cornell Hotel School Dropouts.
Let's pay a visit. We've still got about an hour.
Hey, wait for me!
It was a long shot, no question about it, but we had to give it a try. We located the ambassador. He was with the potentate of Doodly Doo, His Royal Majesty, and one of his wives. We explained our plight, including the immediate danger of the situation. The Doodly Doers were extremely cooperative. They said cartel was sending a car to pick them up and make the exchange. The money for the weather. We hit upon a plan, and they agreed. Posing as the potentate and the aide-de-camp, George, Spiro, and I waited for the limo cartel was sending to pick up the entourage. We were given a quick rundown of the cultural idiosyncrasies of Doodly Doo and hoped we could pull it off.
I gotta tell you, Kate, I feel pretty silly.
You look like a real potentate to me, George.
I feel like a bedspread.
George, here they come.
They explained that secrecy had to be maintained, and they gently blindfolded us. We rode in silence for a few minutes, then got out of the car and were led up a set of stairs and into a room where we took off the blinders.
I'm Ronald Crump of Cartel. Please be seated and accept my apologies for having the blindfold.
We understand, Mr. Crump. As we say in my country, when a camel is great with spheroid, it is not known for whom the ball falls.
I see. Have you brought the money?
As is our custom, my wife carries the money.
Oh, good.
It is a check in the amount of $10 billion and is cashable any place in the world, except Nebraska.
Perfect. And your wife has it?
Yes. This is my 10th wife, Dime.
According to my information, your wife's name is Nicole.
She is my 5th wife. I never travel with both of them. They Nicole and Dime me to death.
I see. And this gentleman?
This is my aide-de-camp, the importantate.
No doubt you wish to see SWI.
Ah, yes. As they say in my country, if the weather yields sun, if the weather yields rain, come on, team, let's see that plane.
And as they say in my country, let's see the green.
Boy, look at all them zeros.
There are plenty more of those where they came from. Zeros mean nothing to us.
May I remind my most esteemed husband of another thing we have in our country?
But of course, my desert flower.
Time's of essence.
Ah, yes. Time is of the essence, Mr. Crump.
And time is money, Mr. Potentate.
And time and the tide wait for no man, Mr. Crump.
And time heals all wounds, Mr. Potentate.
Only if I have a cut on my palm and time on my hands.
I will take you to the plane.
George. You like my little surprise?
It's just a little aircraft carrier.
Wow! Is this yours?
No, this is the Intrepid, a floating maritime museum on the Hudson River. We're just borrowing it.
George, we've only got about 3 minutes before this thing blows up.
Where, if I may query, is the Z-13?
There.
No fooling. It's a dandy.
Over here, Spiro. We've got to launch that plate right away.
I hope so. Let's see.
What's going on here? Who are you people?
Get out of the way, Crump.
Lefty, righty. Take care of these people now.
Don't come any closer. I've got a loaded question here, and I'm not afraid to ask it.
Hurry, Spiro. We've got less than a minute.
One more calculation.
Spiro, only seconds away.
Let's give it a go.
But a deal is a deal. I mean, I've got a check for $10 billion here. You got an airplane flying around someplace.
Benny, you guys are sure a sight for sore eyes.
I followed you from the hotel, George. I thought you might need some help by and by.
Listen, buddy, I don't know who you are, but I have rights.
You sure do. You have the right to remain silent. If you give up the right to remain silent, anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law.
Well, Spiro Gearloose, your dream finally came true. The SWI is launched.
Yes, this Monday, but not for long.
What do you mean?
Having seen the trouble my invention caused, I feel deeply that there are some things with which no man should meddle.
Your own invention.
Yes. But there will be other inventions. I'm working on an electric tree.
An electric tree?
It has the facility to burn itself up so people won't have to have fireplaces anymore. Whoosh! Ciao!
Is that okay?
I think Spiro Gearloose
has a Gearloose.
Lefty and Righty Hand and Ronald Crump were tried in Manhattan court in and for the city of New York. They were found guilty of a Title 18, Sections 371 and 794, defrauding the United States and delivering defense information to aid a foreign government, and a Title 49, Section 1472, aircraft piracy. They were sentenced to spend a very long time in a very dark place.